Hello and welcome to AITPM News. And in this week's edition, we look at election promises. Do they really help transport? Local pollution is a big issue for transport. The 24-hour city and the 200th anniversary of the bicycle. Transport is often an election issue, but does the typical campaign debate help push us in the right direction for long-term improvements? The recent UK elections had the usual trends. Firstly, there is a promise of huge funds. One party put the figure at £40 billion by the end of the decade. City Metric pointed out that the current funding would give you £25 billion anyway, so it is not quite as generous as it might seem. But as usual, the extra cash is likely to be swallowed up by a couple of major projects. Building just some projects, no matter how advanced the technology or how good the artist's impression is, does not constitute a complete policy. Building a project to help complete the rail system, for example, might have merit, but it is not the whole system. A new transport project will be judged on how many people use it, but could the real measure be a combination of two things? How many people could have been served by spending the money elsewhere, possibly including several less upmarket projects, and how many people have not been given a reasonable service? Some political manifestos do dig down a bit deeper, but that rarely makes it into the public debate and is usually defined in very general terms, such as better regulation for bus routes, or projects to relieve bottlenecks, or upgrading the national cycle network. So at the next election, transport professionals have to push the debate to cover the whole system and value for money, rather than election policies which often look like a spending spree when you have won the lottery, only to find that the money has run out when you have a gold-plated Rolls in the garage. Transport service providers are coming under increasing pressure to do more about pollution. In what often appears to be a science-free debate, some suggest that climate change is not an issue, therefore the inference is that we do not need to worry about pollution. But local pollution and its harmful effects is now more than enough for us to push for major changes. At times, London has recorded worse pollution levels than Beijing. More and more medical research is highlighting the adverse health impacts of pollution. Major programs are being developed that give much emphasis to reducing pollution. The EC has just launched its Europe on the Move strategy for clean and connected mobility. We are getting more information. The world's first high-accuracy citywide air quality monitoring system is being built in the Helsinki region. More information is becoming available to the public. Google has released its first map showing air pollution levels captured by its Street View cars over the course of a year. And more groups are starting to push the cause. In Australia, the Electric Vehicle Council has welcomed the Finkel Review's recognition of the important role of electric vehicles in the future of the national electricity market. Groups are challenging governments in court to take the issue further. And some car companies are taking a broad view, including consideration of climate change, and an approach that helps the customer at every step. David McCarthy from Mercedes-Benz in Australia.
The key, though, is where the electricity comes from that you're using to recharge it. There's not a lot of point in having the exhaust pipe in the Latrobe Valley.
Yes, indeed.
And that's why we will be partnering with an energy company that will, and that will be, there'll be renewable energy and you'll have the ability to have solar installed on your house and the storage batteries. So if you're going to go electric, well, it does need to truly be emission-free.
A link to the full interview with David McCarthy can be found on the AITPM website. The 24-hour city has some big implications for transport, and not just in late-night train or bus services. If a 24-hour city is to work, it needs a comprehensive range of activities and transport systems that recognise the multidimensional needs of customers. It needs a focused strategy. Mirek Milan has been the nightmare of Amsterdam since 2012, and other cities are following suit. For a start, the 24-hour city is not restricted to the CBD or King's Cross or St Kilda, although equally it is not going to be everywhere. Safety is a huge issue and compounded when the late night activity is only considered in terms of alcohol consumption. Diversity of activity is essential to ensure a quality and assortment of passengers, not just the perception that they are all drunks. Prominence of staff or security people, lighting and security cameras. These are just some of the measures. And the climate. We have referred in the past to the paper by Professor Graham Curry, Transfer Penalties Vary with the Weather. But this is not just about rain. The warmth in the carriage is critical at night as much as the air conditioning is through the day. And noise is a troubling factor. If we are to build transport corridors to centres in the city that will operate all night, we have to include in the consideration the impact of noise, especially as they travel through suburban areas to get to their destinations. We have a big role to play in supporting the 24-hour city if we choose to have it. Was the invention of the bicycle the result of a climatic catastrophe? 2017 is the 200th anniversary of Baron Karl von Drais first riding his invention of a wooden-framed two-wheeled device with steering that you propelled with your feet on the ground. Europe had had bad harvests from 1812 to 1815, and the 1815 eruption of Mount Tambora in the modern-day Indonesia disrupted weather patterns all over the world and led to Europeans calling 1816 the year without a summer. Crops failed and horses starved, and so folklore says that this alternative form of transport was invented to fill the gap. New forms of transport have changed our whole existence, yet they are rarely accepted immediately. When railways were being developed, people said that travelling at such speed would cause seizure. At the beginning of motor cars, one state in the US had a law that said you had to stop your car and cover it whenever a horse-drawn vehicle went past. In Britain, you had to have someone walking in front of your vehicle carrying a red flag. The same happened with bicycles. When roads were too rough to ride on, cyclists used footpaths, leading to the devices being banned for a period. Next week, we will talk about how bicycles arose from an unlikely form of assisted movement and how they challenged the social status and created greater equity. There are many lessons here for how we adapt to new transport technologies.